Welcome to Tea with Erping. Today, let's talk about the Beijing Winter Olympics, which started on February 4th and will wrap up this Sunday on the 20th. I'm an avid fan of speed skating and often skated on Beijing's Beihai Park Lake before coming to America. Interestingly, Beijing is the first city in history to have hosted both the Summer and Winter Olympics. Those who have lived in Beijing before may find this a bit odd because Beijing doesn't have much natural snow, even in the winter. It turns out for a party state that can produce quite a few counterfeits, fake snow isn't much of a surprise. Yes, this is the first ever Winter Olympics with 100% fake snow. The Winter Olympics motto is Together for a Shared Future. Yet this shared future means something different for the locals. The city's water supply is struggling to keep up with the city's demand. Yet to create 1.2 million cubic meters of fake snow for the Games, Beijing had to divert water from a key reservoir that supplies fresh water to Beijing and resettle hundreds of farmers and their families. Last November, Chinese leader Xi Jinping went to the Games construction site and said he wanted it to be green, safe, and simple. But according to Insider.com, despite the government's estimate of $3.9 billion price tag for hosting the Games, which makes it the cheapest ever, the real cost might be more than $38.5 billion, 10 times the reported amount. There are quite a few off-the-books costs of the Beijing Games, such as the construction of the $9.2 billion driverless bullet train system designed to ferry passengers between Zhangjiakou and Beijing. It appears that Chinese taxpayers are not yet told of these numbers. China does not have a winter sports tradition. In its quest for Olympic gold medals, China has enlisted more than 20 athletes from North America. These days, it's relatively common for countries to recruit talented athletes from other countries. What's unique with Beijing's case is that Chinese citizenship laws do not allow dual citizenship, while the Olympic Charter states that athletes competing for a country at the Olympics must be nationals of that country. There are quite a few drama episodes that follow foreign athletes as they compete to represent China. The San Francisco-born freestyle skier Eileen, also known as the Snow Princess in Beijing, won her gold medal for China in the big air competition. Gu dodged every question that asked whether she is still a US citizen. Her response is, "When I'm in the US, I'm American. When I'm in China, I'm Chinese." I guess scoring the cover of Vogue China can keep a girl quiet. Later, a screenshot of her Instagram exchange with a commenter goes viral. In the screenshot, an Instagram user asks Eileen Gu, "Why can't you use Instagram and millions of Chinese people from mainland cannot? Why you got such special treatment as a Chinese citizen? That's not fair. Can you speak up for those millions of Chinese who don't have internet freedom?" To that, Gu replied, "Anyone can download a VPN. It's literally free on the App Store." Her response angered netizens because it's a known fact China blocks VPNs and punishes those who use VPNs to circumvent the Great Firewall. China also bans foreign social media platforms such as Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Chinese netizens fired off at Eileen Gu and commented, "Why would China build a Great Firewall if VPNs are allowed?" One person was quoted as saying, "Literally, I'm not anyone. Literally, it's illegal for me to use a VPN. Literally, it's not free at all." Not surprisingly, Gu's comments on VPNs is now censored in China, albeit she is at this point still the darling and superstar of the party state. Chinese people feel divided on Eileen Gu. Some feel that she brought honor to China, regardless of her dual citizenship. Others feel that she belongs to an elite class, enjoying privileges too far-fetched from the everyday people. In sharp contrast, Zhu Yi, also Californian-born and a figure skater known as Beverly Zhu in the United States, has gotten a very negative treatment by the Chinese public. She has given up her US citizenship and vowed to compete for China on the Tiananmen Square. Despite this, she has been under attack on Chinese social media after falling and crashing into a wall during a team event, placing China fifth in the competition. You bet. those critical comments are quickly removed by the Chinese cyber cops. The Chinese public, driven mostly by nationalism, is unforgiving if an adopted athlete's performance did not meet their expectations. This athlete's loyalty and patriotism do not seem to matter much. Their performance matters much more. Nathan Chen is another US-born Chinese-American who won the gold medal for US men's figure skating. He was called a traitor and accused of insulting China for his support of American ice dancer Ivan Bate, who criticized China's human rights record. The Chinese state media tried hard to downplay Nathan Chen's gold medal win. Perhaps the most bizarre story involving foreign recruits is the goalie on the Chinese women's ice hockey team. Her current Chinese name is Zhou Jiayin, a Princeton grad who is known as Kimberly Newell in her birth country, Canada. According to a Reuters report, in a post-game interview, Zhou Jiayin answered questions in awkward Chinese and was then asked by a reporter if she could take a few questions in English. She turned to her translator and said in Chinese that she was not allowed to do this, which her translator relayed to the reporters. She is not allowed to speak English, her translator said in English. I'll try to translate for her. Not surprisingly, her English translator doesn't speak English quite as well as this Princeton grad. Yet Zhou was ordered to speak Chinese only so that she would appear to be a native Chinese. After all, losing face is a very big deal for the party state. I know you all may be curious and want to ask Zhou or Kimberly Newell, why? Why is an Ivy League grad put up with such humiliation, being banned from speaking English to reporters? Of the 22 men's hockey players who dressed for China in its 8-0 loss to the US on February 10th, 17 were either born or raised in the US or Canada. This Beijing Winter Olympics is overshadowed by leading Western countries' diplomatic boycott over a range of human rights issues. Civil society groups described it as the Genocide Games because of the massive concentration camps in Xinjiang, forced organ harvesting, crackdown of the pro-democracy voices in Hong Kong, to name but a few. Human Rights Watch called the Olympic motto of higher, faster, and stronger to be the perfect description of the Chinese government's assault on civil society. Some human rights groups liken this Winter Olympics to the 1936 Summer Games in Berlin, where the world allowed Nazi Germany to host the Olympics while the Holocaust was going on. Many critics believe that both events are an assault on the fundamental principles enshrined in the Olympic Charter. The enjoyment of the rights and freedoms set forth in this Olympic Charter shall be secured without discrimination of any kind, such as race, color, sex, sexual orientation, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth or other status. Amid many accusations of referee favoritism for the hosting country, there are press reports complaining IOC helping whitewash Beijing's cover-up of the scandal involving former Vice Premier Zhang Gaoli, the head of this Beijing Winter Olympics organizing committee, and the perpetrator that former tennis star Peng Shuai accused of sexual assault. The international community, including the International Women's Tennis Association, continues to pressure Beijing to let Peng Shuai speak freely. If you are interested in learning more about this issue, do check out my earlier video on this story. Given China's zero-tolerance policy on COVID-19, tickets are not sold to the public, and no foreign spectators are allowed at the Games. It almost feels like it's a virtual thing and not a real Olympics. Little wonder why this Winter Olympics opening ceremony had the lowest viewership in history. More than 350 Games participants, including athletes, staff, and media, tested positive upon arrival in Beijing for the Games. The few foreigners that have visas to cover the Games are not allowed to go out of the closed loop from the airport and the Olympic Village. Polish short track speed skater Natalia Maliszewska told Reuters that she was ruled in and out of the Games several times due to conflicting COVID-19 test results. She said that they told me there's so much politics stuff that you will not understand. It's China. The authorities are constantly harassing foreign journalists, fearing that they will ruin the government's perfect image. The removal of Dutch journalists for NOS by a Chinese security guard went viral when he was doing a live broadcast outside China's national stadium. The IOC was quick to claim this was just an isolated incident and will not affect foreign media's reporting at the Games. According to a report by The Guardian, Beijing also hired an army of Western social media influencers, each with hundreds of thousands of followers on TikTok, Instagram, and Twitch, to spread positive stories about China throughout the Winter Olympics. Vipindra Jaswal, our US-based Newsweek contributor and former executive at Fox News and HSBC, signed a $300,000 contract with China's Consulate General in New York to strategize and execute an influencer campaign promoting Beijing Winter Olympics and the Paralympics in the US. At the same time, Western governments are urging athletes to leave their personal cell phones at home and take burner phones to the games due to cybersecurity concerns. My 2022 is an app required of all athletes at the Winter Olympics and records their health data and COVID-19 status. Researchers from cybersecurity group Citizen Lab said the app has encryption flaws and censorship mechanisms embedded in the app, raising concerns about social and political surveillance by the Big Brothers in Beijing. Organizers have also warned foreign athletes that their accreditations could be cancelled if they speak out of turn. Ironically, the International Olympic Committee, IOC, claimed that Beijing won't bid for the 2022 Winter Olympics because of its focus on sustainability, legacy, and transparency. A UN report on alleged abuses against minorities in the Xinjiang region was supposed to be released in September 2021. We have not heard about it as of now. Many are wondering what is the motive for the delay when international scrutiny for human rights abuses in China is growing every day. According to a Reuters report, the UN Human Rights Council can only send investigators to Xinjiang after the Games, and this will be an arranged visit as well. Just ahead of the Games, 12 Falun Gong practitioners were sentenced up to 8 years in prison in mid-January for providing photos and information of the COVID-19 outbreak in China to foreign media. A half dozen torture facilities serving concurrently as labor camps that hold Falun Gong detainees are only 10 to 20 miles away from Beijing's major Olympic venues. So we have actually two very different parallel worlds side by side in Beijing. While major democratic countries declared diplomatic boycott, leaders of the UN and WHO joined a few dictators from authoritarian countries to attend the opening ceremony, thereby lending support to the communist host. This makes people wonder, what are the leaders of the UN and WHO doing there? Aren't they supposed to take the side of human rights and dignity? Growing up in China, I'm proud of my Chinese roots. And now I'm proud of being an American. No one would be happier than I am to bring honor and respect to this ancient Middle Kingdom. Yet I'm also mindful of the totalitarian regime that is trying to use this Winter Olympics to justify its dictatorship and glorify the communist system, instead of the people who have no voice whatsoever in state affairs. At the end of the day, just as wisely said by Homer, which would you rather be, a conqueror in the Olympic Games, or the crier that proclaims who are the conquerors? Nadia Comaneci, gold medal gymnast, said it well. I don't run away from a challenge because I'm afraid. Instead, I run towards it because the only way to escape fear is to trample it beneath your feet. We all root for a good Olympic event, as we believe in the Olympic spirit for humanism, fairness, and justice. We can't afford to turn a blind eye to any attempt by authoritarian regimes to undermine those Olympic principles. We must have the courage to speak up and protect human values such as truthfulness, compassion, and tolerance. As Ernest Hemingway said, courage is grace under pressure. A cup of fine green tea will help bring you such courage. Until next time, may peace and tea and courage be with you.